I'm given a continuous function, little f, and I define a new function, capital F, of x, and say capital F of x is the integral of little f from some fixed number a. A is a fixed number, a constant, to some variable number x. Yes, that's a variable. This is a way to mathematically construct an antiderivative of little f. But wait a minute, shouldn't I write more here for this integral? Shouldn't I say what the variable is? Yes, I should. Many scientists and engineers put an x and a dx there. Yeah, that's sloppy, and it's so sloppy, I highly recommend not doing it. I mean, you probably won't get docked off on your science test, but in the math test in here, I might say, oh, I'm going to dock you off a half a point. Use some other letter besides letters already used, besides little f, capital F, little x, little a. A common letter to use is U. What does U represent? Nothing, really. It's just a placeholder. Sometimes it's called a dummy variable because it's dumb. I don't know if that's the real reason. It doesn't mean anything other than to say, I need to put something there other than x. You could think of it as an x value. You could think of this graphically. This is a little tricky. Maybe I should label the horizontal axis with the letter U to be consistent here. And I've got some number A, and I've got some continuous graph, little f, of U. And I'm saying, give me any number x. Any number x that you want along this u axis. So x is like a value of u. And compute this area for that value of x. Whatever that area is, it's the value of capital F of x. But I could change where little x is. Imagine I made a mathematical manipulate here. Maybe I will for Friday ahead of time so we don't have to spend too much time typing. And move x right or left. If I change x, I'm changing the area. So I'm changing the value of the integral and I'm changing the value of capital F. And in fact, if I move x to the right of this u-intercept over here, I'm in regions where the graph is below the axis, and so it's contributing negatively to the integral, and the value of capital F will go down. This will construct a new function that can be graphed. Dare I try to graph it here? Oh, maybe. One thing I can say about this new function is that its value at the x equals little a, being the integral from a to a, is zero, because there's no area under the graph above a. It's a line, doesn't have area. So the graph of capital F goes through the horizontal axis when the input is a. If the input's a little bit bigger than a, then I've got positive areas that keep getting bigger and bigger when I'm just a little bit to the right of a. The graph of capital F has got to be going up. And in fact, capital F will be an antiderivative of little f. Capital F prime will equal little f. So think with me here. That means the value of little f, these outputs, will give you the slope of capital F. The slope starts out close to constant here because the graph here is close to constant. but then increases because this graph's going up. It seems to be concave up. Gonna run out of room here. Where will it change to concave down, if ever? Right about there, actually, where the graph of little f changes from increasing to decreasing. So the slope of capital F changes from increasing to decreasing. It'll change from concave up to concave down. And once I reach this point, then little f is zero, so the slope of capital F is zero. And then little f becomes negative, so capital F has a negative derivative, a negative slope. Something about like that will be the graph of capital F. I did not mean to make these graphs overlap. It just happened. I could even graph capital F when X is less than A. Something about like that. Negative values, because when X is less than A, F is increasing. Capital F, because little f is positive and increasing a bit, so it's a bit concave up here. This is an approximate graph of capital F. It is an antiderivative of little f, and that is another part of the fundamental theorem of calculus. Our book calls it, well, FTC2, the fundamental theorem of calculus part 2, because it comes second in the book. To tell you the truth, some people call this the second fundamental theorem of calculus part 1. It's a little strange. FTC2 says the derivative of capital F of X equals little f of X. Another way to write that is to say that the derivative with respect to X of this integral from a to x of little f of u du equals little f of x. You can find this in section 6.4, the end of chapter 6 in our textbook, this fact. Fundamental Theorem of Calculus Part 2, also called, it's got another name, it's also called the Antiderivative Construction Theorem, because we're using an integral to construct an antiderivative. It's saying the derivative of an integral like this, where the variable is in the upper limit of integration. The x there has got to match the x there. Must match. Use different letters elsewhere. The derivative of this integral, where the variable is in the upper limit of the integral, equals the integrand function. Use an x there. Make all those match. Don't use a u. That would be bad, bad, bad. But people do it. So I'm trying to emphasize it would be bad, bad, bad. Don't do it. Actually, I'm not going to test you on this for Calc 1, but it comes up in Calc 2 a lot. So it's worth learning a little bit about right now. The relationship between integrals and antiderivatives is twofold. It goes both ways. You can evaluate integrals with antiderivatives. You can also use integrals to define antiderivatives. They are both parts of what you could really say is a two-part fundamental theorem of calculus. Integrals and derivatives essentially undo each other. They're like inverse functions in a sense, almost. By the way, I'm not going to test you on this, but as a little aside, you can create problems that are a little extra tricky by doing things like this. What is the derivative with respect to x of, and by the way, the value of a doesn't matter, so I could pick something weird like -7, to x squared of cosine of, I'm using a different letter, t to the 4th dt. Okay, I could have used a u. The letter you use there doesn't matter as long as it's different from x. But now I made it an x squared instead of an x, and again, that number doesn't matter. A is irrelevant. It doesn't matter what number you pick for A. You'll get a different antiderivative for a different value of A, but it's still an antiderivative. How do you do this? Do I just get cosine of x squared to the fourth? You could start writing that, but that's not the final answer. it's really a chain rule problem. This function that you see here is really the composition of two functions. The simple function x squared is the inside function, and the integral from -7 up to x is the outside function. I never wrote that integral down. If I had just an x up there by this, the answer would be cosine of x squared to the fourth. But I don't have just an x there. I've got an x squared. So the chain rule says multiply times the derivative of the inside function 2x. And so simplifying the final answer is 2x cosine of x to the eighth. By the way, probably the integral of cosine of t to the fourth as a pure antiderivative problem is not some simple function you're used to. It's probably a non-elementary function. If I typed integral cosine, I'll go ahead and use a t to the fourth, I would be very shocked if this was an ordinary function that you're used to. Yeah, it's not. It involves something called the gamma function. It's also got imaginary numbers in it somehow. This should simplify to a real valued function, though. You can kind of ignore the imaginary numbers. Don't worry about it. Yeah, completely unexpected, but an honest to goodness function that can be plotted, by the way. You can plot both of these functions. I could plot both cosine of t to the fourth and this crazy thing here, just copy and paste it down there as t goes from, 0 to 3. There they are, aren't they pretty? Which one's which? I think the cosine of the t to the fourth is the blue one and the crazy function's the gold one. Let's confirm that doing this. Yeah, the original function, the cosine of t to the fourth, is the blue graph, the first graph. And this crazy thing is the red graph. The graph itself doesn't look that crazy, but its formula is crazy. Okay? The red graph is an antiderivative of the blue graph. The derivative of the red is the blue. Notice the blue is close to constant here. So the slope of the red is close to constant, close to a constant value of 1. But then the blue starts changing here, so the red starts changing its slope. Whether this function is useful or not is another question. It's not clear that it's useful. I mean, it can be written in terms of evidently a function that's useful, gamma. I'm not saying what gamma is, though I will tell you, if you're interested in investigating it, it's related to the factorial function. The gamma function is related. It's a generalization of the factorial function. N factorial, like 10, 3,628,800, or 20. What's that? Million, billion, trillion, quadrillion. 2 quintillion, 432 quadrillion, 902 trillion, 8 billion, 176,640,000. Okay, the factorial function grows very rapidly. So does gamma. In fact, gamma of 21 is the exact same number. Though the gamma function is more general, I can find, for example, what's gamma of, instead of 21, how about 43 seconds? Okay. Well, that's weird. It involves pi. What? Pi? Mathematicians love this kind of stuff. Like, why is there a pi in there? What? Pi is related to factorials? Yes, it is. Astonishing. Amazing. Many people aren't paying attention in the back. This is astonishing stuff. You should be amazed. Of course, you have no idea what I'm talking about because you weren't paying attention. Yeah, gamma can do negatives. -3, maybe? Oh, no, complex infinity. How about -3.5? Well, that's weird. -7/2. Oops. It involves pi. Weird. And it's positive, huh? Who knows what's going on here? It's a mystery. You can investigate. Okay? There's lots of mysterious things in math, but they can be figured out if you have enough time and energy and desire.